What's up, guys? I know it's been a good while since I've actually done a complete rant on this channel. I've been doing my other thing for We Are Triumphant and been quite silent with youth music lately, and I apologize, but I'll be damned before I miss out on telling all of you about my favorites and least favorites from this year. So this is what this is all going to be, a series of videos about the very best and worst of 2016. So I want to start off all these with my favorite albums. So I'm going to do 10 albums, and there are going to be some honorable mentions, because after all there was a shit ton of albums that came out this year that were great, and like I said, there were a few that were disappointing and let me down and just overall were overrated and just not that good. And I'm going to state them in another video, as well as vocalists, guitarists, bassists, drummers, all that shit. I'm going to state all my favorites from this year, so sit back and fucking relax, because it may take a while. Starting way back in this year, this band Somos released their new album First Day Back, and to be honest, I never really checked out any of their material before this album, and I kind of wish I did, because First Day Back is absolutely great. I found myself going back to this album numerous times this year. Like, every week I at least gave it a few of the tracks a spin, and I love it. It's just the mood of it and the overall vibe of this album is great. It's good for any mood. That's basically why I like it. It's that mutual ground of when you just don't know what you want to listen to. This album is a go-to, so if you guys haven't checked out First Day Back by Somos, definitely go do it, because it's on this list. It's top 10 of 2016 in my book, so check it out. Despite what you might say about Shaylee, about his performance live, I know it's not that good. He loses his voice within one song, and I'm not hating on him. I saw them in October, and he literally broke my heart with how sad he felt after that show, and I just wanted to give him a big hug. But that doesn't change the fact that Dayshell's new album, Nexus, is absolutely fucking fantastic. Just the grooves found in this album is fucking awesome. I love just about every single song off of this record. Car Sick, definitely on top of my list. And then Fuck the New World, that song is just bouncy as shit, and it's just great. Every song on this record is fantastic. If you haven't checked it out, then you need to do it now. And just don't hate on Shaylee for being not that good live. Everybody has their rough days. I know he has a lot of them, but cut him some slack, because this record is great. This may redeem your thoughts about Dayshell if you've only seen them live. That's not a very good representation of how this band is. Shaylee is the fucking man, so go check this record out. Avion Roe is another band on this list that I never really bothered to check out their past material until I checked out their new album In Separation, which obviously it's a great album because it's in the top 10 of 2016 for me. Every single song is absolutely catchy as hell. You just can't help but to sing along. And their singer has just an amazing voice. I missed out on watching them at Warped Tour this year. I met their singer. He was very cool, very down to earth, and very appreciative of all the things I had to say about this album. And then it started to rain, and I just decided to get the hell out of there, just because, yeah, Warped Tour is really not that fun when it's raining. So I got out of there, missed them. Now I regret it, because this album is definitely one of my favorites. And then I missed them again, like a week or so. Go. Fuck me. But this record definitely is reminiscent of like 2000s era The Used. It really, really reminds me of that, as well as their past material that I went back and listened to. It really, really just screams The Used. So if you love The Used and you haven't heard Avion Roe yet, pick this shit up now because it's great. Erra definitely has gone through their lineup changes as far as their frontman, and I think now they have landed with a solid choice in JT Cavey, who previously fronted Texas in July, that broke up last year, and he definitely found his place in this band, although my only complaint towards this whole record in whole is that his range kind of just stayed within the same area, and it just kind of got old. But other than that, this record is great. Instrumentation by all the other band members was great. Clean vocals by Jesse Cash. I still say to this day he should have fronted Seosin, because no, that's... Do it already! See, I'm one of those people that thinks Emarosa really wasn't that good when Johnny Craig was in it. Go ahead and fucking shoot me now. I just find that it was boring, and the tempo change in the songs never quite happened because Johnny Craig was really just behind the entire record. Told one producer to go fuck himself and went and back and did their self-titled how he wanted it to be, and it was just as boring as Relativity. Which, don't get me wrong, Johnny Craig is one hell of a vocalist, but you know, let other people in the band shine. Well, since Bradley Walden joined in late 2013, I believe it was, and then they released their album Versus in 2014 with him, and it was great. I thought it was a great change for the band, a huge step up where everybody was noticed and not just the frontman. And now their debut album with Hopeless Records, titled 131, even surpasses Versus. I love Versus, but 131 tops it. It's a completely different direction for the band. It's a lot more pop elements and soul and rock than their previous work that was sort of like a post-hardcore slash rock. But Bradley Walden really shines with his vocals in this record. It's really shows what he can really do, as the first demo was more of a introduction to him. But this really lets him shine through. So if you haven't picked up 131, shame on you, and go do it now. You will know my misery! Yes, this record came more along the end of the year in October, but it fucking slayed its competition as far as metalcore this year. This is quite possibly one of the most solid metalcore records I've heard in a few years, and it definitely tops their last record, Slave to Nothing. Once again, this is another record that was an introduction to a new member, which was Ryan Tuck O'Leary, which is their bassist slash clean singing. And it was good. I love Slave to Deathgrip. Definitely tops every single one of them. They just seem to have that chemistry back and just really have a nice natural flow in this record. Ryan Kirby, fucking as always, slays it with his vocals. Amazing highs, amazing lows, and he's just a solid metalcore vocalist, quite possibly one of the best in the genre, as I have stated in numerous YouTube comments. Every time they post a video or anything, that is all I ever have to say about Fit for a King, is that Ryan Kirby is the best metalcore vocalist. If you don't think so, just go see them live, because most vocalists sound a lot different live and aren't really able to pull off a lot of the things they do on their records. But Ryan Kirby is a beast, and my jaw dropped when I saw them on Warped Tour 2 years ago, and I couldn't pick it up until they stopped playing. And on top of that, Ryan Kirby is just the nicest dude ever. Talked to him 3 times that year at Warped Tour, and he was just very, very chill and down to earth. He even waved to me before he walked on stage. But yes, definitely Deathgrip on top of the list this year, so go check it out if you haven't yet. Now, before you all start jumping on me and telling me what an asshole I am for even mentioning this dick in this video, I don't think he's that much of a dick. Although, you know, what he did to a lot of vocalists, I mean, Maxim Solem on top of a lot of them, was ripped off by doing guest vocals, received money, and never did the feature, which is pretty fucked up. And apparently he did this to a lot of different musicians, and Maxim Solem brought awareness to this to stop it from happening to anybody else. But that is besides the point. Just talking about The Black right now, I thought this was a huge step forward for the band after the trash that was From Death to Destiny. I hated every song on that album, and if you don't know me well enough by now, I hate Danny Warsnop with a passion. If one musician could drop off the face of the earth, it would probably be between him and Nicki Minaj. That's how low I see Danny Warsnop. Needless to say, I just can't wait for his horrible, horrible country album where he does his perfect little Corona jingle in it. Stupidest music video I've ever seen in my life. Have you seen Mexico? Don't watch it. Dennis Shaforstov fucking killed it with vocals in this. He actually can sing. He can scream really good. His highs on this record and in person make your ears ring. And any vocalist that can actually scream to where it makes your ears ring, you know they have something good. Every single song on this, yes, there may have been some like repeated guitar chords here. A lot were reminiscent to stuff on Reckless and Relentless. They lack creativity with the instrumentals, but Dennis, with his vocals, just made this record unbelievable. I've been a fan since Cat Cow Milky Way, if you guys ever listened to that. That's his old pop synth project. Just go listen to it. It's quite entertaining if you haven't heard it. I've always been a fan of Dennis. I've always said he should have fronted Asking Alexandria. He did. He did great. Then he fucked it up and blew it. Now the drunk pirate's back. And I'm just probably going to get back to hating this band now, sadly enough, after such a great record. So let me know in the comments if you agree with my thoughts on The Black. I'm sure a lot of you are going to hate on me for enjoying this record so much. A lot of you hated it and said it's not even Asking Alexandria, and that little emo Ukrainian fuck ruined it. But I loved it, so fuck you. As I was going through my albums trying to pick out my top 10, which to anybody I would imagine that would be hard, it's hard for me, I almost skipped right over California by Blink-182. How in the hell do I do that? Of course, a huge difference in this record is that the departure of Tom DeLonge a few years ago, and then they were on hiatus, and then they finally brought in Matt Skiba from Alkaline Trio to fill in the spot, and that was quite possibly the best thing this band could have ever done. Considering this record may have surpassed any record they've done before, their writing is good old-fashioned Blink still, but you can tell the maturity level in it is there, and every song is catchy, their vocal melodies going together, Mark Hoppus and Matt Skiba of course, their vocal melodies together is great, just their writing together is gold. And working with producer John Feldman just made this even better, because you know how John Feldmann just adds his input to everything, and he ultimately makes every record he works on better than it would have been had it been another producer. Bored to Death is definitely one of the catchiest songs of this year. Go pick it up, or I know all of you have picked this up. Why am I saying go pick it up? Go listen to it now and just, you know, reminisce about how great this record is. Headspace by Issues was actually initially my number one album of the year, but thinking about it, it definitely kind of just drops down to number two after another album that I'll get to after this, obviously. But Headspace was definitely a huge step forward from their debut record, which was the self-titled. I loved every song off of that, and I played the shit out of it. I still listen to that record just as much as Headspace, probably. So needless to say, I am a huge Issues fan. Headspace showed a lot more creativity, and definitely, especially towards screen vocalist Michael Bowen, he does a lot of clean singing in this record, which was very different to hear. At first, I wasn't very liking of it when they released The Realist. I thought that song was rather odd. The creativity and just the overall new things that they showed in this record shows how great this band really is, and I don't really know how long I can ramble about Issues, because I could take up a whole video with just Issues. I love Issues. But like I said, there's a shit ton of great albums that came out this year, so obviously there's some honorable mentions, and a good deal of them, so let's take a look at them now. My friend, help me suppress them! Too Close to Touch, definitely, with their debut album, Nerve Endings. I love that record. There were a few hit or miss songs on it, but overall, I played the hell out of that album, and it's great. Vocalist Keaton Pierce is just on top of many vocalists nowadays with his range. He doesn't necessarily scream, but he has like this high note that he hits where he adds like a scream to it that I find to be one of the coolest things I've ever heard in music. But with Haven't Been Myself, Keaton Pierce definitely surpasses anything he's done on their previous record. Every single song you cannot help but to sing along to. This record is probably the catchiest album of the year. Has the most heart thrown in. It's very personal to the members of the band. The last song, Isley, I believe that, I feel like a piece of shit if I'm pronouncing that name wrong, but I believe Isley is about his sister that passed away last year, And when you know that and you listen to the song, it just brings tears to your eyes. And it's very rare for a song nowadays to make me cry, but this song fucking hit it. It hit it, and so did this entire record. It's so good, and I've listened to it so much that my son actually knows all the words to this record. If he was here right now, I'd have him come down and, you know, show you how much he knows, because it's ridiculous. He knew songs on this record better than I did before I did. So that just shows that if a 11-year-old kid can just get down and actually just love this record, then I think anybody can. So definitely go pick up Have It Been Myself if you haven't yet. They Too Close to Touch is great. They are going to explode, and they're doing their headlining tour starting in the spring. So definitely head out to a date, because I know for sure I definitely am. But those are my top albums of this year. Let me know down in the comments if you agree, and feel free to write yourself a top 10 album list down below. I'd love to hear your opinions and what you thought was great. And I would say leave ones that you didn't think were that great, but that's going to be the next video. It's the most disappointing slash overrated slash albums I did not think were very good of 2016. So if you guys actually want to go ahead and leave comments down there of your least favorite, so I can maybe compare or see, you know, if we agree or anything like that, go ahead and do that. Hit that like and hit that subscribe if you are not subscribed to this channel yet, so you don't miss out on all the other reviews, end of year reviews, I'm sorry, for this year. I got a lot coming, so definitely stay tuned. And definitely don't miss out on my show, Unsigned and Unheard, found on the We Are Triumphant channel. Hope you guys enjoyed this video. Try not to hate on me too much below. Peace.